Hey guys, in this video I want to talk about how I plan bigger projects and how you can plan your project so that you can actually finish the painting that initially seems super scary to do. So this isn't like beginner level project, but a project that seems like you need to learn multiple skills and you need to draw multiple objects, and it just seems quite scary in the beginning. So for me, this painting idea was quite scary because I knew that there is so much stuff and that the background is going to be quite busy, but I still wanted to keep the main focus on the windows of the coffee shop. So how I started to do this painting is by doing color blocking. And the way that I do this color blocking phase is that I block in all the main elements that I want to be the main visual impact of the piece as quickly as possible. I really can't stress enough how important speed is in this phase. I don't advocate speed painting, but when doing blocking, I think it's really important to keep moving quickly so that if an idea is bad or something doesn't work out, so you have that sort of like momentum that you don't feel too bad when you need to erase or repaint entire areas again and again. But if you get stuck with details in this phase, that is really going to cost you later on, and that could just mean days and days of work that you need to fix later if you don't spend enough time in this phase to just like quickly throw out ideas and see what works and what actually fits your composition in this piece. Once I had this whole composition down, only then I started thinking about what is the perspective and how to get those qualities right in this image. Because perspective is something that is quite technical and it's really just labor. Especially in Procreate, where you can use vanishing points and drawing assist, it's not that difficult. So as soon as I know that where I want all the main walls to be and where I want the main windows to be, I can kind of fit them in the perspective quite easily. It doesn't matter if my quick sketch doesn't match one to one, as long as I have that main visual impact that I intended in the initial sketch, then I'm all good. The reason why I do this line art in the first place is because when you have a bigger project, I really think that the most important thing, not just for this piece, but for any bigger project that involves a painting that requires a lot of planning or using different techniques, is to first focus on that area where all the other aspects are built on. And in this particular case, it's this main design of the window, the placement of the windows, and the perspective of the entire coffee shop. If any of those features are off, or that I notice later that I don't like them, or that the perspective is off, then I will have to fix everything that is built on top of that. And since this is the main subject of the entire image, that would mean repainting the entire image. So when thinking about your bigger project, identify what is the main thing that you need to get done right, otherwise it might cause work later on. In this case, it was quite clear cut for me, and that's why I decided to use a tool that I don't often use on this channel and in my videos, and that is line art. And I'm going to explain why I wanted to use line art in this case. So the main element of this coffee shop is this big ornate window. I wanted that to be very decorative. I think the best, and by best I mean the fastest way to do that design part, is through line art. And because Procreate has this symmetry tool, I used drawing assist and I drew in symmetry so that I only needed to draw one half of the symmetry and the other side would fill in automatically. Sure, there are unsymmetrical features in the main design of the window, but those I would just draw without the drawing assist being on. And you can click on the drawing assist by clicking on the layer and clicking the drawing assist. But first you need to have symmetry selected in your drawing assist menu. I didn't draw the main design in perspective because I knew that I can use transform tool to set it into perspective. This works because the main design of that window is mostly flat. So I would only add the sort of like hints of perspective into this frame of the window in the painting phase. But for the design purposes, I just drew it completely flat and just used transform to set it into perspective. And for that reason, I have the main perspective lines of this building visible almost at all times in this process. I know that it might look quite ugly, but it's just much easier to do this sort of a painting with the perspective lines on. So sorry about that, but it really helped me. And this painting took so long to make, so it just sped up things so much. For the line art, I wasn't interested in designing features that didn't need line art. So if there are any elements that I think that I can just paint them without line art, then I would just skip them. So the entire line art looks quite sparse, and that is because I only focused on areas where I needed to solve visual problems with the tool of line art. The line art itself is going to be completely gone by the time that this painting is finished. This line art is really just planning. And I wanted to touch on one topic about line art, because I've been doing paintings that have these sort of like decorative elements so many times. And one thing that always surprises me is when you have line art on just white paper, it always looks a bit more decorative than when you have those lines filled in. So I would say that the appearance of detail cuts in half once you have painted that line art. When I'm doing like a decorative element that is supposed to look really detailed, I really go overboard with the details because I want that to be like really punched in, because I know that once I have the colors in there, that detail is going to be just like slashed in half. This is just something that you don't have to fail many times when you know this information beforehand. About the brush that I'm using in this illustration. For Blanket of Waves illustration, that is sort of like flat graphic illustration, and for this painting, I used my own Mikko Rala brush from my own brush set. And this brush I wanted to use in this piece because the Blanket of Waves is quite graphic. It has a lot of like flat graphic surfaces, but it's using the same brush. You can see in the beginning of that live stream when I started to do that illustration that I accidentally started painting with that brush. But it's just about how you use it. There is pressure sensitivity in Mikko Rala brush, but you have to kind of have a very light touch, and that's something that I'm using for this painting. And lighter brush strokes with that same brush also generate a lot more texture. In Blanket of Waves, I don't have that texture as much because I'm using a lot more pressure. And that's not a brush setting. I'm using that texture in many places here because I have, for example, the ground plane that has a lot of this sort of like gritty textures in there. So many times I'm just like painting an entire sheet of texture and then using transform tools to make the whole scene look more grounded by adding that sort of like texture in perspective. Because I wanted to have this painting done in high resolution, I was constantly aware that I can't use too many layers in the beginning, because if I have, like, for example, overlapping elements, then I'm going to need to stick to those layers for the rest of the painting session, and then I can't use temporary layers when I want to just quickly do something by using different layers, for example, clipping mask or layer masks or whatever makes that painting process go faster. So for bigger projects like this, I would recommend not having too many overlapping elements. Even if you're working in Photoshop where you have endless amount of layers, even still, I would recommend not having too many overlapping elements in the beginning, because it's just going to get really hard to work on like the whole bigger picture if you're not working on the painting in a quick way. And if you have 100 layers, it's going to be really time consuming to always identify where to get to that layer and what other layers are affecting that color. So even if you had the choice of endless amount of layers, I would still avoid it in bigger projects, because you really should consider the editing phase to do all of those smaller color tweaks. In the bulk of the painting, you should just focus on the main elements and not have everything overlap. So for example, if there is like fog, lens flare, or anything that affects many elements at once, I would preserve all of those effects as the last thing, because they are probably not going to be defining your entire composition anyway. It's just going to be like candy on top, so don't go for that like fancy effects part too early. That will just take away so much time, and it's going to be a headache to deal with like color picking and how the different colors react later on in the process. When I was doing this painting, I was also having this coaching session with one client, and one of the main things that I told him, this artist, is that the backgrounds cannot be too busy. And I remember thinking that like you are doing a coffee shop in the middle of this like huge metropolis with like hundreds of different lights. How are you in any sort of position to tell this freelance artist not to make too busy backgrounds? Anyway, I tried to fight against like the busyness of the background by washing away a lot of that contrast by having a lot of light and haze there. So there is a lot of detail, but at the same time, it's not really sticking out. And the way that I tried to achieve this is by making all of the windows quite similar. And I avoided like super hard edges, even though they are windows. The way that I made the windows is just, I basically made an additive layer and just generated a mess by using that soft touch on that Mikko-Rau brush. And then I set it into perspective to kind of block in a few houses. And then I used the erase brush with the drawing assist so that I could erase direct straight lines to create the illusion of windows. But I wasn't creating hard edges for every single window. It's just the same texture for all of the buildings. So the detail looks similar enough that it doesn't look too interesting. In the end, I think I was able to achieve that what I wanted, for there to be buildings but not interesting buildings, if that makes sense. In this whole piece, there are so many different reflective surfaces and metals and all kinds of elements that are bouncing lights from one another. And to achieve this, I used one trick that I have done in many of my own paintings, and it's recycling the materials in your existing painting. I think it's a waste of time to browse the internet to find the right textures for your painting when usually your painting already has all the necessary materials that you need, and they are probably better suited for your painting than something that you could find in a stock library anyway. So the way that I do this, for example, if I want to have blurred reflection on a metallic surface, I use the copy canvas and then I paste the entire canvas and then I blur it, and then I use that as a material to create textures of reflections. It doesn't matter if it's not like 100% accurate. Using the same colors that are already in the painting really helps to unify everything. If I had just pulled these textures from somewhere else, it would look copy and pasted together in a weird way. It's just super fast also. This is a huge time-saving trick that you can use on pretty much any painting. If you have water surfaces, if you have glass or metal or pretty much anything shiny. One more benefit of this recycling in your own painting is the flow that you manage to keep when doing that. Because if you have to exit the painting program and go online and look at the different pictures, you're not painting anymore. So it's the same as using like hundreds of different brushes. Every time you kind of like stop to look at menus and make those sort of decisions, you're not thinking about your painting anymore. But if you can keep your vision in your own painting and keep the work going, it's just going to let you get more stuff done in a quicker fashion than exiting the program and quitting basically the whole work session there. Because it's always going to be harder to see what was the painting again. Does this texture match my scene, or doesn't it? Do I need to go back and search for a better one? All of that is just like unnecessary clutter that you don't need to deal with, because most likely you can generate the textures yourself, or you have them already in the painting that you are working on. Just steal from yourself. That is always somehow super fun and satisfying to do. At one point I realized that I had been painting this whole thing for several days already, and I hadn't added the snow yet. And snow was always one of the big reasons why I wanted to have this thing done in the first place, because it's a small cozy coffee shop that has warm lights inside. It's just going to add to the contrast if I have this cold snow visible outside, and I didn't add that in the picture beforehand. And I think this is definitely a mistake because it was a risky move. I got really lucky that it ended up working, but I realized that it might as well not have worked at all the way that I had envisioned in my mind. And the way that I could have avoided this terrible fear is that in that blocking in phase, I should have already added snow just to see if the colors work with the main composition or if it's feasible to add into this illustration at all. I should have done that in that fast blocking phase already because it's a major element of the entire piece and it's a big part of this entire mood. So don't do as I do in this regard. Planning is really important and planning should include all your main visual elements. The smaller wall of this coffee shop on the right, that was done using the same method used in the brick house painting, but the main wall I did all by hand. And I don't really think that that added much considering how much time I wasted doing that. So I would prefer using that brick house method in the future because it's faster and it provides the exact same results in a much faster time scale. So definitely when doing these sort of like bigger projects that have multiple elements and require a lot of design work and have a lot of technical details, whenever you can save time in any phase, just do it. Like, there's no art police that is going to come to your house and say that you're doing your art wrong. Just do what you want. And I think it's more important to finish and publish your piece than to do it in any certain specific way. Publishing is the most important thing in painting. When creating this building, I think the most fun aspects for me when designing any type of architecture or environment is just seeing the history appear around it when I'm working on it. Sure, you might have a great idea in the beginning, but it's just going to be so much better when you think about all the different details. And for example, in this case, I wanted the city around the coffee shop to be kind of like contemporary looking with all these different neon lights and glass. And I wanted this small coffee shop to be like one of those old buildings that is preserved because of the architecture, but they didn't know the value in the beginning, so this sort of like bridge-like extension was added some time ago and it's made out of cheaper wood, and there is also the owner's own house on top of this coffee shop, and it also looks kind of like cheaper and made out of completely different materials. So it's kind of glued together and shows the progression of time. Those sort of elements give an environment a sense of place, a sense of identity when you think about these details, and those are also the most rewarding things to do in any sort of like environment design piece because you get to live there. And that is the whole reason of this painting. Now, I was thinking for a long time if I'm ever going to even publish this part of the video where I say why I made this painting. And I understand that the reasons I have for doing this painting are like the definition of first world problems, and I would never prioritize these issues over anyone's safety or well-being, so please understand that. But just in the name of full disclosure, I noticed that the nearby library was open a few days ago and has been closed for almost the entire year. I usually go to that library to paint on my own because I just get a lot of work done there in that environment. I love books and it's usually very quiet, and it's really nice to go there with a cup of coffee and just work on an illustration. When I went there, there was this big sign that like maximum 6 people in at once and only take the books that you have already ordered and walk out. So it was basically still closed, which is fine. And I completely understand that. And it's a responsible thing that they are doing. And of course, I walked out of there right away. Then I had this feeling of anxiety that I hope that I can soon go to a coffee shop and paint, like, of course, when it's safe. And I wouldn't do it now, of course, it wouldn't be a responsible thing to do. But I just felt like this is like really suffocating because I feel so lonely and isolated being here by myself and painting all day. So I thought that like maybe I can paint my own coffee shop and I can be in that space, because I would never have the guts to talk about this to anybody because people would say that like this is a first world problem. It is. It's completely silly and it's not important. There are much bigger problems that people are dealing with that are just like way more important than my silly loneliness. But still, this was a real feeling, and I thought that like since I have the ability to do something about this, I can create my own coffee shop. So I started doing this painting and it worked. I made this illustration for a really long time and I got to spend time in this environment and thinking about all the details. It really took me away from this workroom and this space, and it was a real gift and I'm grateful for that. But I know that this is like a silly problem, but this painting helped me. It made me feel like I'm just not here for a small moment. I have just opened memberships for this channel, and this membership program allows me to post longer format videos. So for example, this entire process is in a 3-hour 30-minute video that is available now for my members. And of course, I'm gonna add more stuff to my membership, like community posts and all other cool stuff. I'm really excited about this new aspect of YouTube, and I'm going to be making more of these long format videos that are available for my members. This doesn't exclude the content that I'm going to be posting on my main channel that is freely available for everybody. These videos will still happen. These memberships also help me to make more videos, because if I have these memberships, then I don't have to take on as many commissions, and that is all time away from me making videos. So if I'm available to use more of my time to work on this channel, then I will get to spend more time with you guys. So I hope that you can all be supportive of me, whether you're a member or not. I thank you all for being on this channel, and I really don't say this enough. I usually don't ask anybody to subscribe or like my videos, because I think people know how YouTube works, and I think that's a waste of time that I don't want to waste your time by doing that same process. But I just wanted to thank everybody who has already subscribed and has watched my videos. That already helps. So I thank you for being here with me, and I hope that this time in this coffee shop has been as fun for you as it has been for me. I can't help looking at this coffee shop and feeling grateful for having had the experience of making it, because it came at the time when I really needed it, as silly as that might be. Okay, I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.